Declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were a people, you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
In the Old Testament, there are three offices God set that steward his relationship with people. The first of those offices is the priest. And the priest's job is to bear the burden of people before God. The priest's job is to interface with God on behalf of the people. Aaron was the first of the priests. But my favorite priest of all in the Bible is Samuel. I remember that when in 1 Samuel chapter 7, there was this battle that the Philistines came up against the people of Israel. And Samuel fought that battle by prayer. And the people of Israel came to Samuel and made a demand from Samuel that reveals the ministry and the unique importance of the office of the priest. 1 Samuel chapter 7, we read in verse 7 and in verse 8. It says, when the Philistines heard that Israel had assembled at Mizpah, the rulers of the Philistines came up to attack them. When the Israelites heard of it, they were afraid because of the Philistines. They said to Samuel, do not stop crying out to the Lord, our God, for us, that he may rescue us from the hand of the Philistines. That's the job of a priest.
Yes.
He interfaces with God for the good, for the well-being of the people of God. The second office that God established in the Old Testament was the office of the prophet. The prophet's job is to speak God's word to the people. The prophet brings the counsel of God and declares it to the people. We have so many prophets in the Bible, and actually Moses stood in that office of a prophet. And of course, we know about Samuel, we know about Jeremiah, and so many of them. Then the third office God had in the Old Testament is the office of the king. The king is the governor. He governs God's people according to God's law. He doesn't govern according to his own whims and caprices. He governs God's people according to the decrees and the direction that God has given. Those offices are so unique and important, but you can combine being a king and being a prophet at the same time. But there is none of them you can combine with priesthood. You can't combine being a king and being a priest. Nobody ever was. You can't combine being a prophet and being a priest in that real sense of it. The office of the priest is so unique. When people try to combine those offices and usurp the authority of the priest, God punished them seriously. The first example was King Saul. Remember the story of Saul? God had asked him to go and fight the Amalekites. And David, Samuel had said, wait for me, in 7 days I'll be there to offer the sacrifice. But the guy was not patient enough. He went and offered the sacrifice, thereby stepping into the office of the priesthood, which was not meant for him. He lost his job because of that. Well, of course, we also know about Uzziah, the powerful, very good king. I love that guy. That guy did a good job. But just towards the end of his ministry, he went and created trouble for himself by stepping into the temple to offer sacrifice that wasn't meant for him. God does not want that. The office of priests and that of a king was reserved for Jesus. And the reason is simple. Until the sin of the world is completely taken away, that office should not be handled by any two people. However, it has always been God's intention to have his people as kings and priests. In Exodus in chapter 19, in verse 1 to verse 6, we read the first interaction, the first intimation of God of his intention to have all his people to be office, to be priests and kings unto him. Exodus chapter 19, verse 1. On the first day of the third month after the Israelites left Egypt, on that very day, they came to the desert of Sinai. After they set out from Rephidim, they entered the desert of Sinai, and Israel camped there in the desert in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God, and the Lord called to him from the mountain and said, "This is what you are to say to the descendants of Jacob, and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourself have seen what I did to Egypt, and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you obey me fully," take note of the word fully, "if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations you will be to me a treasure, you'll be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation." Amen. These are the words you are to speak to Israelites. The condition is, keep the covenant of God and obey him fully. But unfortunately, nobody did. Not even Moses obeyed fully. Nobody in the Old Testament fulfilled that law. And of course, if you don't fulfill the law of obeying God fully, you can't combine the office. You can't stand in the office of a king and in the office of a priest at the same time. Only person who could do that will be the person who obeyed God fully. And again, the person that keeps the covenant of God. Well, they couldn't do that. Nobody could have done that. Thank God that he Jesus came. Because if Jesus didn't come, nobody, none of us here, can ever claim to have obeyed God fully. We don't even know all the commandments of God in the Bible. I'm not sure anybody here knows having there. And then you now, how can you begin to obey what you don't know? So we give God praise. In Philippians, in chapter 2, we read this beautiful testimony of how Jesus obeyed God. All right? Philippians chapter 2, we read in verse 5 to verse 11, it says, "In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as of a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even the death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Lord, the glory of God the Father." Jesus obeyed with all his heart. He obeyed with his life. He demonstrated his obedience by being willing to be sacrificed on the cross of Calvary for our sins. And because he did that, he fulfilled the condition to become a priest and a king, all rolled into one. Now, how did Jesus become that? First, the first qualification for him to become a king and a priest was He's the very fact that he was the Son of God. In Hebrews chapter 5, Jesus, the Bible tells us, every high priest is selected from among the people and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God and to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. He is able to deal gently with those who are ignorant and are going astray, since he himself is subject to weakness. This is why he has to offer sacrifices for his own sins as well as for the sins of the people. And no one takes this honor to himself, but he receives it when called by God, just as Aaron was called. In the same way, Christ did not take on himself the glory of becoming a high priest, but God said to him, "You are my son. Today I have become your father." And at another, and he says in another place, "You are a priest forever in order of Melchizedek."
Hallelujah.
Now, the sonship of Jesus qualified him to be a priest and to be a king. And remember, in the Old Testament, God didn't have children there. He has, I don't know what to call them. Nobody becomes a child of God until he gives his life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Unless you are born again. The Bible says he came to his own did not receive him. But as many as received him, to them gave him power to become sons of God. Only Jesus gives people power to become children of God. And so, at this point, Jesus was the only person. That's why the Bible calls him the only begotten Son of God. We realize that after resurrection, that tongue was dropped from the mouth of the Bible. It doesn't speak about Jesus as the only begotten Son of God. Now look at Hebrews chapter 7 in verse 28. The further evidence of the importance of sonship in becoming a high priest in the priestly ministry of Christ. Hebrews chapter 7 verse 28. The Bible says there very clearly, "For the law appoints a high priest man in all their witnesses. But the oath which came after the law appointed the Son, who has been made perfect forever." All right. So Jesus, because he had obeyed God fully, was made perfect forever. And because he was Son, he was nominated to the office of the priesthood. Now, the second qualification that Jesus had to qualify him for that office was that he learned obedience through suffering. You see, obedience is an important thing. Remember, God said, "If you obey me fully." And Jesus, I don't know why the Bible used this term to say it. It's really surprising that Jesus learned it. How he learned it? Jesus, who is God, he didn't come here as God. He came as a human being. None of us has the natural gift of obedience. Nobody has. We always learn it. All right? We begin with our parents. Then we say, "Do this," and insist we will do it. In that process, we are learning obedience. Now, Jesus also learned it. In Hebrews chapter 5, in verse 7, this is the testimony of the word of God. "During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Son, though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, and was designated by God to be high priest in order of Melchizedek." Therefore, on the basis of his sonship and on the basis of his obedience, perfect obedience, which he learned through suffering, he was fully and unquestionably qualified to combine the two offices of king and the office of priest. That is why Hebrews says in chapter 7, of verse 20, in chapter 7, verse 26 to verse 27 of Hebrew chapter 7, the Bible says this: such a high priest truly meets our need, one who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. Unlike the others, the other high priest, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once and for all when he offered himself. He sacrificed for their sins once and for all and when he offered himself. That singular sacrifice, which is unrepeatable, is not, it can't be repeated. You can't, it's not, you are not reenacting it in the communion service. No, you can't. That singular sacrifice set Jesus apart as a high priest of all believers.
Amen.
Jesus, therefore, is both priest and king, and the virtue, by virtue of our common destiny with him, anybody who puts his faith in Christ automatically becomes priest and king. We didn't achieve it on our own strength. We become that because we share common destiny with Christ. Remember, God's eternal purpose is for us to be conformed to him. We are predestined, you know, to become like him. So we have common destiny. We have common, you know, goal. Whatever Jesus is, any of us can be, and any of us is. All right, whatever anointing we see upon him, you have a full right to go and claim it and lay claim on that. You have a full right to do so. That is why the Bible tells us in Revelation, in chapter 1, in verse 4 to verse 6, John proclaimed, you know, bear this glorious testimony. John to the seven stars in the province of Asia, grace and peace to you, from him who is, and who was, and who is to come, and from the seven spirits before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us, and has freed us from this, from sin, from our sins, by his blood, and has made us to be a kingdom of priests, to be a kingdom and priest, to serve God, his Father, to serve his God and Father. To him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Jesus, having fulfilled all the conditions conferred on you and me, the unique and the uncommon privilege of serving with him as kings and priests. As kings, we are to exercise authority on earth. That is why he says, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given unto me. Go and make disciples of all creatures. We have authority over every created reality. We have authority over demons. We have authority over the sun, over the sky, over everything. And that is why human being has conquered everything. We have, human being has conquered gravity, conquered all kinds of laws. All right? Because it's our kingly duty. It's our kingly duty to exploit the kingdom of God. It's our kingly duty to harness the resources of nature. It's our kingly duty to scan the depths of wisdom and understanding. I mean, you may think that the world, we have come to the highest level of development of science and technology. We are beginning. We are beginning. All right? More things are going to come that we make what we know today to be kindergarten. All right? More things are going to come. It is God's ability in man. It's God's mandate on man to conquer the earth, to exercise dominion of the earth, and to why the spirit of enterprise must be recognized and honored in the life of every man. Enterprise is part of God's creative anointing for us to rule on earth as king. That's why a human being is ambitious. An average human being is you can't stay alone. I mean, you want to be somebody. You want to get higher. You want to conquer. Why? That's the kingly anointing. God wants us to possess the whole earth. He wants us to conquer this world for him. Remember that in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve were not, God didn't develop the whole world, the whole earth at the same time and release the two men, the couple to live in it. But the Bible said that God built a garden, east end of Eden, and put Adam and Eve in it to tend the garden. What's the idea? That Garden of Eden became a kingdom of heaven outpost on earth. And what it's supposed to do, as they exercise their kingly authority, they will expand that garden until the whole earth is covered. All right? Remember that Satan was here already causing trouble before Adam arrived. All right? And so the idea is that God created an oasis in the kingdom, in Eden, which I call the outpost of God's kingdom. And God now says, as you stay here, expand the territories. Keep expanding the frontiers of the kingdom until you cover the whole surface of the earth. Unfortunately, they didn't do that. But that's what the church is doing today. What is the church? Church is the power-holding company of heaven. Amen. All the resource of heavens is in the hand of the church. There is no power of God that God has that was not entrusted in the hand of the church. Every power. What did Jesus say? All authority in heaven and on earth are given unto me. And who did he give the authority to? He gave it to the church. He said, I give it to you. Go and make disciples of all nations. We must bear that in mind. That is our kingly right. When we think of that, we think it's just mere evangelism. No. We are supposed to dominate anywhere we are. I mean, wherever a child of God finds himself, you are supposed to exercise your right as a king. You have no business being a junior staff in your office when you have the capacity of being the managing director. You must work yourself to the highest position and take over. When I talk to her, I say, I want to see you at the top. Don't ever be satisfied with any small thing you are. And if you're a businessman, when you make your first €1 million, don't be satisfied. Because there is somebody else who is making €1 billion when you are making €1 million. Are you getting the point? You know, there are people out there who are in 1 minute, they'll go and harvest €10 million, and then you go there and get a couple of cents. Why? We must insist that the kingly anointing God has placed on us will not be wasted. Amen. We must exploit it and deploy it for the work of the kingdom of God in Jesus' name. Amen. Then as priests, what does that demand on us? Because we are speaking on royal priesthood today, let me give you five points of before I say that. The major job of a priest in relation to God is to offer God sacrifice. That's the central job of a priest, is to offer God sacrifice. In the Old Testament, you offer God sacrifice on behalf of others. In the New Testament, that order is no longer there. You don't need me to offer God sacrifice. Because every believer is a priest. And every believer is a king. You see, I'm sorry, but we pastors try to create trouble a lot by creating the impression we have greater access to anointing than you. And so if you must get blessing, we must pray for you, you know, for you to be healed. We must pray for you to prosper. We must pray for you to be blessed. That is not true. It's not true. A believer is a believer. A pastor is a pastor because God called him into an office. That does not give him any iota of spiritual advantage over you as a king and as a priest. Yes. And pastors should be able to encourage them. And that is why we come to church. Only a few people are active. The rest of the people are just there
You're just listening and going, and nothing is going on. And our world will remain like what it is today. Everybody is supposed to be like the pastor.
Yes.
Okay? Everybody is supposed to know what everything the pastor knows. The business of a pastor is to pour every information he has and every anointing upon him unto every member of the church. So every member of the church will be like him.
That's right.
Wasn't that what we saw in Moses? God told Moses, I'm going to come down. Bring 70 men. I will take anointing from you. He didn't say, I'm going to manufacture a brand new anointing. He said, the one that you have, I'm going to reduce it. And I'm going to give it to your people so that they can help you in the war. Two people didn't go to the church that day. They were latecomers. And the Holy Ghost came before they were able to get to church. And they began to prophesy in their tents. And Joshua was jealous. So look at these people. They didn't obey the instruction. Now God became so liberal that he baptized them in the Holy... Sorry, he put the anointing of God upon them, even in the tent. He said, Moses, should I go and shut them up? Moses said, are you jealous because of me? How I wish that all Israelites are prophets. Old Testament. May God give us the magnanimity of Moses in Jesus' name. Say, how I wish... all Israelites are prophets. A couple of years ago, I did a conference and I said, I want all the pastors and bishops and everybody to attend, and I want you to come with your workers, come with your pastors, associates, and what have you. One big man of God, then that time he was in TV. I was not in TV then. I was just, I was going to sit at the back of his church to learn how he was preaching and how he was doing that. He got up and said, Cosmos, I said, yes. Do you mean you want me to bring my choir leader, my ushers, my Bible study coordinators, my assistant pastors in the same conference? I said, sir, yes.
Yes.
He said, if we come to the same conference and learn the same thing, when we go back to our church, who will be teaching the other? He got up there and insulted me, saying, you don't understand anything about pastoring. You didn't go to Bible school. You didn't go to seminary. You can't do what you... I said, I'm sorry, sir. But I thought that the job of a pastor is to help the people to understand. And if you go to a conference with them, they already know what you know, so you teach them some other things. You won't bother yourself about those matters. As I'm talking to you today, that man has no church anywhere on the surface of the earth. Because if you're not willing to give, you can't keep people. I was starting ministry at that time. I didn't have a church. I was even in a primary school. All right, at that time, I was just beginning, but I was serious in helping other pastors. Any little thing I know, I want, and I have friends who are big pastors who are doing well. I said, let them come and teach us how to do so.
Yes.
Now, he is no longer anywhere. My church has grown from being a small church to become a big cathedral, from being a small collection of 7 people to 650 branches all across the world,
yes,
in America, in Europe, in Asia, in Africa, everywhere. You don't micromanage, you don't pinch grace. You don't micromanage anointing. If you do so, it will leave you. That man has no church anywhere today. He's lost. One day he called me. I said, where are you? He said, he's somewhere in, is he an ambassador of Bayesa State? I said, come and see me now. He said, man of God, if you get things are hard. I said, come, let's see what we can do to help you out. But his problem was that he wasn't liberal. He wasn't willing to impart what he knows to people.
Yes.
And of course, nobody will follow you who is not growing.
Yes.
What did Jesus say? Follow me and I will make you better than who you were. You are catching fish now. I will teach you how to catch men. In other words, if you follow me, I will give you greater opportunity to achieve more, to succeed more, to become better. The number one business of every pastor and every minister is to make people under you to be better than you.
Amen.
As much as you can. As much as you can, make them better, better, better than you. And that is why I push my pastors like no man's business. In fact, by September this year, 7 of them will be graduating their doctorate degree with their PhDs. 7. 7. Why? I want them to be educated. I want them to know what they're talking about. I want them to understand what they are saying. As I don't want to, when I come to a meeting, when I make a statement, they will catch me. They won't want me to be repeating myself for 10 times. So Jesus God does not want us to continue with the sacerdotal priesthood of the Old Testament and that of the Roman Catholicism, where one man, if you want to become a Christian, he must baptize you before you become a Christian. If you must grow in grace, he must do confession for you. If you must receive the Holy Ghost, he must pray for you for confirmation. If you must die well and go to heaven, he must give you a strict unction. In other words, from beginning to the end, they just package you and you are just dependent on one man. It's not God's will for us. God wants us to be, full-blown grown children who can interact with him, who can hear his voice, who can see him, who can get whatever we can get out of him and use it to accomplish the goal and the purpose for which he created us. May God bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, having said that about the priest, since all of us, including the children, we are all, if you have any child that is born again with the Holy Ghost, he is called to be a priest and to be a king. And the principal job of a priest is to offer sacrifice. What do we offer to God? I was going through my scriptures to find out the kind of things a New Testament priest should bring to God. And I was amazed at the things that God was requesting. I found out that God didn't ask for money. God didn't ask for goat and cattle. God didn't ask for cars and houses. God didn't ask for things that we thought we should have expected him to ask for. Let me give you a list of 5 things that God demands that we bring to him for offering. Number 1, he wants us to offer ourselves. Romans chapter 12, verse 1. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. God calls that worship. A priest is a worshiper. That's primarily. A priest is primarily a worshiper. And what do you worship God with? Present your body. But what is that, what we call worship? Worship is singing some slow, dragging some songs. You know, if you sing it fast, it is praise. Then if you drag it, it becomes worship. But he said that this is our true. Let me read it again. He says, this is your true and proper worship. What does that mean? Present your bodies as living sacrifice.